Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. Dr. Ben, good afternoon and welcome.
Good afternoon, my brother.
It's good to have you here with us.
It's a beautiful thing to be here. Obviously, the forces of life heard the prayers of my brothers and sisters when I had my momentary shutdown the other day.
Yes, well, I want you to know that the grapevine was strong because word reached us, boom, like that. But apparently, boom, like that, you were recovered.
Yes, my mindset went back and a few chops up at Pan Pan, but two chops on the mind helped my recovery.
So you look well, though, nonetheless.
Thank you about that. I do feel much better, and I've been pushing on a manuscript by I finish it, the response to the ADL, page 48. I did a 44-page monogram, which I hope will be published no later than next month. And I'm going to send the first copy come off the press to the ADL, as usual, saying what I have to say, and so that it will have no doubt. I will give them a chance to certify me as I said, anti-Semite, but better than that, a self-hating Jew.
So More importantly.
Yes, exactly. I mean, whatever they have to say, they can say it, so I'll show them the documentation of what I've said that caused them to say that I'm anti-Semitic. And the anti-Semitism that they're talking about is the fact that they became Semitic being Khazars, and they hate to know that. Because the book that I refer to, which I said, the Blacks and Jews, an old confrontation, and it is an old confrontation. There have never been a time when European Jews have been friends to any kind of black people, including black Jews. And that's what they're mad for me to mention that. And I will continue to say it because it's a historical fact. It still is. There was a time that white Jews didn't want the world to know there was such a thing as black Jews. They hide that for up to now in America. You ask how many black synagogues, white synagogues, got black Jewish members. Ask them how many. Ask them how many black rabbis are allowed to preach in any black synagogue, a white synagogue. Ask them. It's not me. It's still the fact is still here. That when white Christians took in black Christians, ministers, white Jewish synagogues haven't taken equivalently or in the proportion or near the proportion of black rabbis.
When what was the title of the monogram again?
I named this type this monogram
Blacks and Jews and old.
No, I called it. Let me make sure they get the exact title. I said, I just turned it over 2 days ago for the final typing. Isn't that something? But it ends like this. I have a colon, and then I got, to me.
I was mainly keying in when you said blacks and Jews. I think it's an old confrontation.
Well, that's the title of my old book.
The old book.
One of the old books, which they name in the ADL report against blacks.
I see.
You on page 47, 48 too.
Oh, okay, brother.
That's
thank
the
you.
Same thing.
Okay, yeah.
And they refer to that book, whereas the quote what other people write from their work, they never quoted what I write. They just mentioned the book.
I see.
Blacks and Jews. An old confrontation, and my response to them, forget me, but at the end of the title is the ADL hit list.
Okay.
That's what it is.
I was keying in on this idea of old confrontation, in that it's so interesting that when you speak, and on this subject we're talking about today, religious thought and practice in Africa before Judaism, before Christianity, before Islam, that we wind up in this particular conflict when we talk about Judaism, and whether we talk about Islam or Christianity, people still seem to not grasp that there was a major world religion created
before
by black people.
There was
before
a single
them.
Jew.
Yes.
And that's why they're mad with me. They're mad with me because I constantly point out that long before there was a God called Jehovah, long before there was a man called Abraham, long before there was a so-called first beginning with a man called Adam and a woman called Eve in a garden called Eden, that thousands of years Africans had religious concept which the Jews came and copied. Whether the Jews were black, brown, technicolor, Jews copied. From the first Jew, Abraham, all the way, copied and changed. From the first written document out of a Jewish institution, otherwise called the Sanhedrin, about 700 before the Common Era, the documents they used were copied. The story of Moses is a copy of the story of Osiris. It is a copy and a plagiarized version of that. The Ten Commandments came from the negative confessions. If anybody wants, they could go out now and buy a copy of the Book of the Dead, and they will see in the rare section of that called the Osirian drama, they would see those 42 laws which the Ten Commandments was copied from. The concept of one God didn't come from the Jews, even if it was a fellow named Moses, because Moses talked about one God after Akhenaten had already died and preached about one God called Aten. That's why I'm talking about why people are angry. The Christians are angry. The Muslims are angry with me for it, for pointing out that Judaism, Christianity, and Islam are copies and changes to what the Africans are preaching on the Nile.
There would be a point, though, here to ask, I mean, why be angry at something that ultimately is just simply what came before?
Because they have lied to themselves and have told themselves that they got the only true religion. And they got the only inspired religion. And they want to be the first, and they're mad that somebody has beat them to it. Even the black ones would prefer the slave master religion. The black Muslims would prefer to have a foreign man bring them a religion and say it wasn't slavery. The Muslims don't want to admit that most of them became Muslim under slavery, under slaves for the Arabs. The Christians don't want to admit that their Christianity, most of it, came from the enslavement under European power. There's a handful of Christians who come from the influence of Christianity coming from Ethiopia, the Copts. That's only a handful. But a vast majority of Christians, black Christians, come as a result of slavery and colonialism. The same thing goes for the Muslim. Vast majority came from Arab enslavement and Arab colonialism. And these are facts. Mm-hmm. They can't deny it. The history is there. The date is there. That's why they don't have dating system in the Bible or the Quran or the Torah.
What I'd like to do, and I know that this has been raised before, and I know that there are a lot of sensitivities on all sides about it, and what I'd like to do today is maybe even spend more time talking about what the religious thought and practice is that we're talking about that does precede Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. What is this thought? What is this religious practice? And then perhaps that lays something out for everyone that we can then discuss.
We'll do that with time, mm-hmm. with a timeline.
Okay.
And that's why I said when people talk, they need a timeline to refer to. Remember, we have nothing written by anybody, said by anybody, about a God named Jehovah until the birth of Abraham. He's the first person to mention a God called Jehovah, right? And Abraham's birth is not before 1700 before the Common Era, at best. The Africans along the Nile are already in their 14th dynastic period. 14th dynastic. That's the dynastic period. I'm not talking about the pre-dynastic period. I'm not talking about the civilian period. That's way, way, way advanced at that. So you can't talk about Jehovah. You can't talk about anything about God, Jehovah, Abraham, a Jew, or nothing until at least the Africans are already in their 14th dynastic period. Now, since Judaism precedes Christianity and Christianity precedes Islam, we don't need to mention those other two. We know we're talking, anytime I'm talking about before the 14th dynasty, I'm not talking about Judaism, Christianity, Islam, mm-hmm. because don't exist. Mm-hmm. All right. Mm-hmm. The Africans are already worshipping by that time the goddess Nut. She's considered the goddess of the universe, goddess of the sky. They have already worshipping God's shoe, who keeps up her in the firmament. And they're very worshiping God Geb, the God of the earth that keeps her raised. Now, the Africans are already worshiping a God of the Nile, Bes, right? They're already worshiping Ra, this, and symbolized by the sun, okay? They're already worshiping Isis, Osiris, his brother Set as the bad god. All that before the thing called Lucifer or devil. All this the Africans are already doing. Mm-hmm. And that's before the birth of anybody named, before there's an Adam and Eve, a garden of Eden mentioned anywhere, because before of anything called the flood. I mean, that's the historic data. No one can deny it. They already got a story about Isis giving birth to a child by virtue of an immaculate conception. And there's no Mary yet. Thousands of years before there's a Mary. Hatshepsut is supposed to be born of an immaculate conception and taught as the goddess Hathor or Heru. Mm-hmm. She is worshipped. Even the Jews came and worshipped her as the golden calf. In Exodus, they said that the Jews, Moses and his brother had an altercation, and his brother Aaron made a golden calf. But the Bible refused to mention that the golden calf was symbolic of goddess Hathor. Even the Jews went and built a goddess, a statue of a goddess.
Let's work with that for a moment, because one of the elements that comes up when people will look at that, at any phase, it's not even just that phase, but any phase of quote-unquote Egyptian religion, is that they will have a concept of paganism based on what they will see in their own view as animal worship and so forth and so on. Please comment on what this religious thought and practice was about and what those figures are about.
Anything that isn't your religion is paganistic. Paganism is anything you if you have a belief and somebody has some belief contrary to yours, they're the pagan. Mm. And they're saying you're pagan. Mm-hmm. So the pagan is the opposition religion. Because those same people that call things pagan use the temples of the pagan for their religion. You've been there to Egypt with me, and I show you all the things where the Christians went and occupied these temples, use it, where they went and took the paint and different thing and paint over the so-called pagan things and use it for their own. Now, what happened is people have been so conditioned, brainwashed, that when they come and see something older than theirs, they can't accept it. They just wipe it away with a statement. Let me give you a best example.
Okay.
Every year, thousands of people come to Egypt by way of Israel. And they come to Egypt only for one thing, to see the pyramids the Jews built. The fact is, of the 82 pyramids that were built in Egypt, every last one was built before the first Jew was born. That's a historical documentation. Not a single Jew was born. Abraham, the first Jew, was not born when the last pyramid was built. The last pyramid was in the 12th dynasty, and Abraham's birth was in the end of the 13th dynasty. Okay? No one can deny, not a single Jew could deny this. Therefore, when they come to Cairo to see the pyramid. First of all, there's no pyramid in Cairo. But they come to Cairo. The closest pyramid, it would be the one in Giza, across the river from Cairo. The one that they come particularly see is the largest one, the one of Khufu, which the Greeks call Cheops. They go there. They touch it. They go in it and notice there's no brick of any material. There isn't one brick of any material in that pyramid. You saw it for yourself. They're monstrous stone, yet they will come back and say they saw the pyramid. I took one of my daughter, who's a Jehovah Witness. I took one of my daughter, put her in the pyramid, let her touch it. And she came back and said, did you see any brick there? Noah, something must have happened. My daughter is no louch, and she looked at that thing, saw it, but could not tell herself. Mm. Huh? Brainwashing.
Hold on, we'll take a break. Dr. Ben is with us inside of the GBE. There's more to come from 1190 The Choice. We'll also be taking your telephone calls as well in our next half hour at 692-9542 and 1-800-332-1023. What was the view of these particular Africans who were operating in terms of their religious and spiritual practices before Judaism, Christianity, and Islam? We'll talk with Dr. Ben about it when we come back after this. The Global Black Experience, yours from 1190 The Choice, 1236, 24 minutes before the hour of 1 o'clock. Don't forget, Dr. Dees makes a radio house call right after the 1 o'clock news today. We'll take your telephone calls for Dr. Ben. Joining us today for our African Religious Experience, our theme is we've come to the crossroads. Where do we go from here? Don't forget, Dr. Ben will be there with Dr. John Henry Clark, Yatrice Lee, Professor William Mackey, and Dr. Arthur Lewis, and myself as your moderator for a panel discussion called Where Do We Go From Here at IS 258 at 141 Macon Street in Brooklyn, April 22nd at 7:30 p.m. It's an evening dedicated to Dr. Ben and his work. We're talking today on religious thought and practice in Africa before Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. We'll take your calls, as I said, for a quick moment, I want to talk to Dr. Ben. Dr. Ben, I want you to, just for a few moments, if you would, talk about what that religious thought and practice is that would have been practiced in ancient Egypt before the evolution of the other world religions. What is it that they believed?
The concept of life itself, for example. The ancient Africans along the Nile, and in particular Egypt, where the zenith was, that man has two souls. That's the crux of it. What is he? He's made up of these two entities, the heart, soul, or the ba, and the spirit soul, or the ka, B-A-Ba or K-A-Ka. And those two souls are housed in the body, or the cat, K-H-A-T. That's the fundamental basis of religion, mm-hmm. or the philosophical concept, theosophical concept of the ancient African.
Mm-hmm.
And that the man comes to an end while the world continues. The Jews, the Christians, the Muslims, what they did is take this and end the world. The world will come to an end. The ancient African thought the man comes to an end at a periodic point in his life, but the world continues. Just like you die. Mm-hmm. But your son will go on. Your daughter will go on. The world don't end because you end. You see, but the European couldn't think of a world that goes on after him. So he got the world going to end one day after he gone. So it didn't end now. He going to be right there. Only for him, but not for the elephant, not for the dinosaur. You understand? Now, they taught in this that man is not in himself bad. Like the Christians today and the Jews, and that man is bad by and in himself. Especially when he got a thing called the devil. The ancients taught that man got the value of good, bad, and indifference. In other words, man does bad things, good things, and he sometimes does things which he isn't conscious of, one way or the other. And we know that. Man, you yourself go through things yourself.
Always,
so
yeah.
To make sure that is so, man, the ancient said, for everything there's an opposite. For a good God, there's also a bad God. The good God, for example, is Osiris. The bad God is his brother, his twin brother, Set, right? Mm. It's strange that the Jews pick up Set in the Adam and Eve. It was Adam and Eve, Cain, Abel, and Set.
Mm-hmm.
all right, there's a lot of things they're going to pick up. And that, above all, no one can see the ultimate and live. No man sees God and live. No man. Why did the ancient pick up the sun as the symbol of the highest authority? Because no man see the sun. Not only live, it bust your eyeballs open. It would bust your brains open to look at the sun. None of us have ever seen the sun. We see rays from the sun. And no man, I said, no man sees God and live. That's true. You can't see the sun. You will not live. Right? It will bust your eye open. Your brain will bust open. And that's where it comes from. So from those basic teachings along the Nile, all the other concepts came out, because these were refined much later.
I want you to, before we go to the phones, and let me just make sure that I say this for our brothers and sisters who are listening from a variety of faiths. I know that there are obviously Jews listening, Christians who are listening, and Muslims who are listening, and so forth, that there's certainly no offense intended by whatever analysis that we're doing, but we're attempting to really deal with what occurs before, what comes before.
What came before Judaism, Christianity, and Islam?
Yeah.
And there were teachings before, whether you agree with it
or not,
follow it or not. Historically, no one in his right mind, don't care who he is, can say that these teachings did not precede Judaism, Christianity, and Islam.
And ultimately became a part of them.
Yes,
is what you're saying.
I'm not saying either it's right or wrong. I'm saying it preceded.
Yeah. But I guess, Doctor, not only preceded it, it winds up being, to some extent, the basis and influence.
It made Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. Yeah. Judaism, Christianity, is lifted from these teachings, basically. Fundamental values.
Mm. All right, let's bring in some telephone callers inside of the GBE at 1241, 19 minutes before the hour of 1 o'clock. 11 Night of the Choice, you're in the air with Dr. Ben. We're, of course, dealing with the African religious experience. Good afternoon. Hotep, good afternoon.
Hello.
Yes, you're in the air.
Yes, Dr. Ben?
Yes, sir.
Good afternoon. You know, it's really, really amazing that this morning I was here thinking of you, sir. And I really, really mean that. I did not know that you were going to be on the air.
Mm.
And I said, two of the people in this world that I intend to follow consistently is Dr. Ben and Dr. Clark. Hmm. And here I turn the radio on and you happen to be on. It's amazing. The question that I would like to ask you, sir, is that names like Farrakhan and Muhammad Ali, are these authentic African names?
No. Farrakhan and Muhammad Ali are Arabic names. They are not African names.
So in other words, that when Muhammad Ali said that he was changing his slave name to another name, what he did actually did is he changed his name from one slave master to another slave master.
That is true. Ali was the brother of Muhammad, the Prophet Muhammad, and there's some group. The Sunnis and others believe in the Prophet Muhammad. The other Muslims believe in his brother Ali, that God had given the power to the brother Ali, and that's the fight that's going on now between the Sunnis and the Almohads and others.
Mm, that's interesting. So Muhammad Ali's name actually joined.
Muhammad Ali was named Far, but he doesn't know it, didn't know it. But Muhammad Ali was an Albanian who converted to Islam and became the head of Egypt, the great grandfather of Farouk.
Interesting. You're inside of the GBE, the Global Black Experience. Good afternoon and welcome. You're with Dr. Ben.
Gary?
Yes, sir.
It'll be interesting to know that this at the end of this year, Halle Berry is planned to start in the production playing Queen of Sheba. So it'll be interesting who will be Solomon.
Yeah, I saw that. I had the same question in my mind.
Right. I'd like to ask Dr. Ben.
By the way, I'd like to change the name from the Queen of Sheba. There was no Queen of Sheba. She was the Queen of Aksum, which is today called Ethiopia,
right,
and Empress of Sheba.
Oh, right. Mm-hmm. You're right about that. People get confused calling, you know, Ethiopia and Abyssinia and those other names. I have to say something too. I wanted to discuss this. Maybe you can get into this, Dr. Ben. You said that Egypt reached its zenith, but I would like to know, after Egypt reaches zenith, I would like to get into the Nubian religion and the Nubian.
The Nubian religion was the exact same religion as the Egyptian religion, as the Ethiopian religion at that period of time. It was the people worship along the Nile, a common religion, and the first god to worship at the Nile was called Bes.
What are the changes, Dr. Ben, that take place, or significant changes, I should say, that take place dynasty to dynasty, and how did they ultimately change in any way religious thought and practice along the Nile?
Well, the first dynasty, you see, Manetho was the one that placed Egyptian civilization into periods called dynasty in trying to explain it to the Greeks.
Mm-hmm.
But the Egyptians themselves didn't have dynasties. That was a method Manetho used to explain to the Greeks. Manetho was the last of the high priests living during the time of the Greeks. The Greeks killed him. See, when they felt they didn't need him anymore, they killed him, as they had killed all the other high priests. And so, if you ask a Greek of that time, come back, what dynasty you come from, you wouldn't know what you're talking about because they didn't have dynasties.
Mm. You're inside of the GBE, the Global Black Experience, with Dr. Ben Hotep, and good afternoon.
Hotep, Dr. Ben and Brother Gary.
Hotep.
I'd like to start by thanking Dr. Ben for everything that he's done to bring knowledge to African people about our ancient civilizations. On the issue of religion, I personally had some problems accepting Christianity. My family's Christian, although I haven't really grown up in a Christian. I didn't grow up going to church. But I think that Christianity keeps our people too complacent. We have the power to get so many people together, and then we don't really do as much as we should be doing. But I'd like to know, I saw a videotape of a speech Dr. Ben gave a while back at the African Cultural Arts Center, in which he stated that some of the books of the Bible were actually taken from older stories out of Africa. So I'd just like Dr. Ben to speak about what should we actually be following, and how do we get this older information?
Well,
thank you for the call.
If you want to follow the oldest of the traditions, then the Book of the Dead, the Book of Knowing Ra, all of these books that are available, you will then have to go back to the written documents. You take them in the Medinetra. If you can't get them, get translation of those books. But they are all available to read, the various papyri.
Mm-hmm. There's a place, Doc, and I know that there are some brothers and sisters that I've talked to in different parts of the country, and I'm sure you've come across them, in the Christian faith, I know in particular, who are, as they are becoming aware of this information, getting to the point that they are trying to figure out how to adapt it in such a way that they can present it to their congregations, because
yes,
they are understanding that.
Some ministers are doing that. Some of them have been going through different prayers.
Mm-hmm.
That goes back to the Book of the Dead, or the Book of Knowing Ra, and also like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So it is beginning to happen now.
Oh, yes.
The country, yeah.
They're adapting it into the Christian worship and so forth.
The irony being that if we talk just about the area that, and I think the caller is referring to this type of thing, when you mentioned the Ten Commandments, but then you say the Ten Commandments come from, as you showed us when we went to Egypt, the 42 negative confessions.
And they are written in the Book of the Dead. They could buy a copy of the Book of the Dead as translated by Budge, and in the rear section see all 42 listed there.
So as opposed to having just 10 commandments to go by, suddenly you get another additional
32
to deal with.
Yes, right.
You're inside of the GBE, the Global Black Experience Hotel. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. I just wanted to tell both of you gentlemen that I love and respect both of you and keep on doing what you're doing.
Thank you.
And the question I have specifically is that I was wondering if you, Dr. Ben, were aware of an article that ran in the Daily Challenge a couple of years ago, which cited the Egyptian government announced discovery of ancient Egyptian royal mummies stored in boxes and crates in the Cairo University Medical Facility, which date back as much as 3,400 years. And my question is, well, among those relics were...
They didn't discover them there. What happened? It was as late as Sudat. We protested, a number of us, protested the showing of mummies like Anconia. And during the time of Sudat President, Sudat passed a rule that they could not show the mummies anyway. And then they put them in crate in a room just 3 months ago. Unfortunately, because the state need money, since tourism went down, they put the mummies back and show.
Mm.
You pay extra money when you go to the museum and you can see the mummies now.
Well, my question is, What is the reason for, well, this particular article mentioned King Zoser, the bones of Queen Neith, wife of Pepe II, and the fetuses that were said to be the children of King Tutankhamun. Now,
Tutankhamun had no child, one child.
Okay. But the question is, the article that ran in the Challenge was questioning the motives behind the Egyptian government having these very important relics stored in a room and not, either being studied or...
I told you, they were not stored. They were being in the public. I am one of the persons who protested the display of these mummies. We did not get until President Sadat came. He agreed with us that they shouldn't be on display. And he placed an order, a presidential order, that they be removed from the public and stored in a room.
Mm-hmm.
We demanded that they be stored in the tomb or in the pyramid that they were taken from. That didn't happen. But when tourism became low recently, the government needed for money. They put the mummies back on show for money, so to raise money.
So on the issue of motive, you're saying
it's
that was
money.
The motive. That
money
was
is the motive.
To the caller, we thank you for the call. I think that explains it. So
and my protest was they will not take the hair of Muhammad and show it on the public display. They would not take, if they find, the bones of Mary or Jesus and put it on public display. Then why take the ancient Egyptian and put them on the public display as a Coney Island thing?
We'll take a break and we'll come right back with more of your calls for Dr. Ben from 1190 The Choice. You're listening to 1190, The Choice. This is Imhotep Gary Byrd, and this is the Global Black Experience. 5.5 minutes before news at the top of the hour at 1 o'clock. Don't forget, right after 1, it'll be Dr. Gerald Dees making another radio house call. Let's go to New Jersey with another call for Dr. Ben as we move through the African religious experience. Hotep, good afternoon. Yes, good afternoon.
Yes, 1190?
Yes, you're in the air. Where are you calling us from?
Yeah, I'm calling from Jersey City, Brother Mwaka.
Go right ahead, brother.
Yes, I'm calling about, what's this book, right? Hebrew rights, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the brothers were saying that this is the true book. And I want to know some history on it from Dr. Ben.
What does he mean by the true book? What make it true or untrue or whatever it is? What is the true book? What does he mean by that?
Like, he spoke about the Quran, too. He said the Quran is the truth.
Wait now. All the other books before the Quran are wrong?
Pardon me?
All the other books before the Quran, are they wrong?
Yes.
Wait now.
Okay.
What if all the other books before the Quran are wrong, what made the Quran right?
I'm listening.
Oh, he said he's listening. So he the point is he's saying someone told him that. Someone gave him that idea.
You're getting the answer. You mean to tell me God let all the other books from different religions made and then wait till the Quran and then the Quran adopt things from the other book to become the only right one? Mm-hmm. The Quran adopt the story of Adam and Eve. It adopt the Garden of Eden, and that comes from the Torah.
There's also an understanding, I think, that I know I came to at one point where a Prophet Muhammad talked about respect for people of a book.
And other books.
Yes.
All the other books they must listen to.
Yes.
That they don't have their own intelligence.
And this is Prophet Muhammad, isn't it?
That's the Prophet himself, but these little individual prophets going to say that Muhammad was wrong.
Mm. You're in the GBE, the Global Black Experience with Dr. Ben from 1190 The Choice. Good afternoon.
Hetepu.
Brother
Imhotep. Well, I can't pronounce the rest of your name.
That's all right. You're working well.
All right. I have utmost respect for you as well as Dr. Ben. Dr. Ben, I go back with you to, I was a little youth on 125th Street and chock full of nuts. Well, passing through there.
Yeah.
We had those sessions in there.
Yeah.
Anyway, what I wanted to say was that you can't begin until you start with one. You know, one is the first, and that's the creator. And from then forth you come, and you have took us as a people back to that oneness that brought forth all that which we believe in and participate in terms of religion today. What I wanted to say was that...
By the way, there's one is the female. You said the creator. Would you concede that the creator then is the female?
Well, from the loins of a black woman... As you call heaven.
That's all right, but I just want to know where you're
at. Just checking out
that. That's where you're at.
Second, but what I wanted to get to was that I wanted to thank you, first of all, for freeing my mind from the shackles of monolithic thought in terms of religion. And I don't know what to call myself. I was raised as a Christian. I went into Islam after going to Africa and so on and so forth. But the thing I wanted to bring up, the most important point, that you use the word brainwashed. And this has been a thing with me. I'm a Virgo, and I'm a very particular person about language and the terminology that we use. I don't think that our brains have been washed. We need to have our brains washed of the programming that we have been inundated with that is misinformation. In other words, we have been misinformed, and we have been inundated mentally with knowledge that is not correct. Our brains need to be washed of the misinformation and reprogrammed with the knowledge of ourselves and our people. I adopted the name Haru in terms of that name. What I read about the name was that my strength is in my wisdom, and I said to myself, everybody can call me a wise guy. All through my life, you're a wise guy. You always talking to me. So, okay, my strength is in my wisdom. Yeah, I'm a wise guy. We may be an idiot.
So I'm saying,
by virtue of you, you know, and what you have taught and what I've listened to you repeatedly say about our culture, our people, our story, I have the utmost respect for you. I'm passing it on to my youth. I have two sons, and you will forever live in my heart, in my life, in my mind, and in my family's life, and you will never die, Dr. Ben.
Wow.
I wouldn't fight you on semantics. Yeah. I will accept either term. It's sure that you understood what I mean.
Yes, it did. That's a wonderful tribute, though, too.
Yeah.
And really, Doc, it talks and maybe relates to the remark that you made earlier about the world continuing. And there is an aspect to this, I think, that happens with someone like yourself, like Dr. John Henry Clark. And I share, I think, the brother's perspective that you really have become literally a living ancestor, I think, for many of us, because what you've given to us is something that we'll never die.
You see, one of the things I have not done is to say, this is the beginning of all things. I have found ancient things, but I'm looking for something even more ancient. I have not found it all. I continuously look. The problem with most of us is that we shut our mind and say there's nothing else. And constantly I'm finding other things beyond what I found. For a long time, from 1939, I believe that Imhotep designed the first stone building ever in the world. Well, just 2 years ago, they've now dug up a building 9,000 years old, 4,000 years older than the one that Imhotep did. Now, what am I going to do? That's why I was saying,
not change with what you know.
And brother, you notice I always say it is the oldest to date.
To date.
Keep my, it's a good time. I allow myself that slip in space. Now I can slip and said, there's one more earlier.
Yeah.
I said to date.
To date.
The oldest to date.
Always new discoveries
there's
to be made.
Always something else.
Yes.
And we now, they're now exploring. Nobody, they know who did this, but we know it was the foundation of a temple near Abu Simbel, and that's 9,000 years old. What are Europeans going to do now?
Well, of course, in this particular
case... What Adam and Eve going to do now?
That's right, exactly. In this particular case, as brothers and sisters know everywhere, Dr. Ben's work continues, and perhaps that last example is a great example to why. This particular evening coming up April 22nd is dedicated to Dr. Ben and his work. And I like one thing that's said on the fly. It says, we're urging the African community to help him bring our story to us. It is true. You can mail contributions to Dr. Yosef Ben-Jochannan at 40 West 135th Street in New York, and you can call to come to the event that we're doing on April 22nd. Where do we go from here? 718-855-1812. That's 718-855-1812 at IS 258, 141 Macon Street. Again, it'll be featuring Eutrice Lee, Dr. Arthur Lewis, Professor William Mackey Jr., Dr. John Henry Clark, Dr. Ben, and myself as your moderator. We'll look forward to seeing you there. Dr. Ben, thank you. Good seeing you. Hotep, brothers and sisters, stand by. Dr. Gerald Dees is coming up next to make a radio house call. 1:30 today, it'll be Seeds to wrap us up inside of the GBE, the Global Black Experience.